Welcome, everyone, to the University of St. Francis Bishop Darcy Stadium for a great exhibition soccer match between the Indiana University Hoosiers and the Notre Dame Fighting Irish. The Hoosiers are the winners of the 2012 National Championship. The Fighting Irish won the National Championship in 2013. This past season, IU had a 12-5-5 overall record, 3-3-2 in Big Ten play. They lost 2-1 in the opening round of the NCAA tournament, in the second round to Xavier, 2-1. Notre Dame won their second round game in 2014 against Ohio State and lost in the third round to Virginia, 1-0. The Irish were 12-5-4 overall in 2014, 6-1-1 in ACC play. Virginia went on to win the national title in 2014, beating UCLA 4-2 in penalty kicks, winning it 1-0. Notre Dame won 2-1 over Maryland back in 2013. The Hoosiers won 1-0 over Georgetown back in 2012. IU has 8 national championships under their belt. That's second best in NCAA Division I.
We are glad you're here for the Shindigz National Soccer Festival annual spring soccer game between Indiana University and Notre Dame University, or the University of Notre Dame, I should say. Today, all of us, the kids from the Fort Wayne Sport Club, are honoring their director of coaching, Mike Clark. He's a past All-American in Indiana and played professionally with the Columbus Crew. And we're happy he's here in Fort Wayne. You'll see him in a few minutes when we do the coin flip. We also want to thank some of our sponsors, just a few of them. Shindigz, Hall's Restaurant, Don Hall's Restaurants, and you know they have a concession stand here. You've got cheeseburgers, hot dogs, pulled pork sandwiches. The Indy 11, that's the new protein down in Indianapolis. New Image Printing, Star Technology, Parkview Sports Medicine. Those are just a few that we want to thank. Also, we should thank, though, Alco, Classic Products, and Ian Rowland. And by the way, speaking of Alco, you do have time. There's beer and wine under the grandstands. Also, soft drinks, water. So grab yourself a sandwich from Hall's and a beverage at the concession under the grandstands. You'll find it, not hard to spot. Then grab yourself a seat, grab yourself a scarf for $10. Sit and enjoy the game, and afterwards then, go down on the field for autographs and pictures.
Folks, the coach of Indiana University is Todd Yeagley in his fifth season, and the coach of the University of Notre Dame is Bobby Clark in his 14th season. Todd Yeagley was the coach at Wisconsin in 2009 before taking over the Hoosiers program. As a player, he was a 4-time All-American at Indiana, that is Todd Yeagley, during the 1991 through 1994 seasons, and in 1994 was named the Missouri Athletic Club National Player of the Year. During his stint as a student athlete in Bloomington, Yeagley was a 2-time academic All-Big Ten honoree. He led the Hoosiers to 3 Big Ten titles in 91, 92, and 94. As a player, IU had a 79-9-5 overall record. So that's Todd Yeagley, the head coach at Indiana, during his playing days with the Hoosiers. Talk about the Herman Trophy given to the top player in the country. IU has just got a plethora of players who have won this trophy. In 1978, the first player was Angelo DiBernardo. In 1981, it was Armando Betancourt from IU winning it. In 1988, Ken Snow won it, and then Ken Snow won it again in 1990, the first 2-time winner. Brian Mesonueva won it in 1994. Todd Yeagley was the MAC Player of the Year that year. Danny O'York won it in 2004 for IU. He's the last Hoosier to take home the trophy. The first ever winner for Notre Dame was Joseph Lapira back in 2006 when he led the nation in goals scored and points. Joseph Lapira. Notre Dame, an ever-improving program, competed in the Big East for years, now part of the ACC. Coach Bobby Clark was hired back on January the 19th in 2001. Heading into last season, a career record of 323 wins, 132 losses, and 66 ties. At Notre Dame, his record, 170 wins, 69 losses, and 41 ties, a winning percentage of .680. That's Bobby Clark entering this past season. Of course, last year, Notre Dame, 12-5-4, 6-1-1 in ACC play, 8-3-1 at home, 3-2-1 away. They opened up this season at St. Louis at Herman Stadium to a draw at zeros. No team has won more national titles than SLU, that is St. Louis University. They come in with 10 national championships, the last one coming in 1973. IU won its first in 82. They have 8 national titles. Virginia has 7. Virginia picking up their 7th national championship in 2014. They also won it in 2009. San Francisco has 4 national titles, 66, 75, 76, and 80. UCLA with 4, the last one coming in 2002. Maryland has 3, the last one coming in 2008.
And now welcome the University of Notre Dame and Indiana University men's soccer teams. Indiana University in red, University of Notre Dame in white. For Notre Dame, the starters, number 3, Connor Klekota. Number 7 is Danny Lojek. Number 10 is Brandon Aubrey. 11, Oliver Harris. Number 15, Evan Pankin. 16, Michael Shipp. 23, Jeffrey Farina. 25, Patrick Berneski. 26, Mark Gormley. 27, Patrick Hodan. And in goal for the Irish, Chris Hubbard, number 13. For the Indiana University Hoosiers, number 2, Billy McConnell. Number 3 is Derek Creviston. 4 is Femi Hollinger-Jansen. 5, Grant Lillard. Number 6, Jack Griffith. Number 7, Matt Foldesi. 9 is Austin Panchot. 10, Tanner Thompson. 11, Cory Thomas. 14, Phil Fives. And in goal for the Hoosiers, Colin Webb, number 32. Our referees for this match in the center, Andrew Bigelow at AR1. Doug Ferguson, AR2, is Ben Trevino. And the fourth official is Vlade Jovevsky. We have to do the coin flip, and we have something special for the coin flip. And that is the Fort Wayne Sport Club Youth Soccer is proud to have Mike Clark on its staff as Director of Coaching. And we honor Mike today by sharing his accomplishments in the game of soccer. His soccer resume is extensive. His coaching experience aligns directly with long-term goals of the Fort Wayne Sport Club Youth Soccer. Mike attended high school in Detroit Country Day, private school located on 4 campuses in Oakland County, just north of Detroit. He was a 4-time state champion and named high school All-American. He was a 4-year starter under heralded IU coach Jerry Yeagley from 91 to 94, named captain and All-American in his senior year. Clark reached the Final Four with Indiana University in 91 and again in 94. He was drafted by the Columbus Crew in 96. The inaugural MLS draft was a 2-time MLS All-Star. He currently sits second all-time, only behind Chad Marshall in career games played, which is 221, games started, 216, and minutes played, 18,942 for the Crew. Mike was part of the late 90s era Crew team that was made up of several Indiana University standouts. They included Pat Noonan, Jurgen Sommer, and current IU coaches Todd Yeagley and Brand Messidoff. He helped the crew win the Lamar Hunt U.S. Open title in 2002. He's also assistant coach at Canterbury High School during the latest state championships they had 2011 and 2012. Congratulate Mike on his accomplishments. Mike, let's do the coin flip.
Moments away from the start, this big matchup here between the Irish of Notre Dame out of South Bend, Indiana.
Ladies and gentlemen,
and the Indiana Hoosiers.
Rise, take off your hats.
Out of Bloomington, Indiana.
Take our flag for the national anthem.
Forty-five minutes on the clock here as we get ready to start the first half. Folks, these two teams did meet up in 2014, and it was Indiana getting the win 1-0 in Bloomington over Notre Dame at Armstrong Stadium. At the time, Notre Dame was number one in the country, IU at number eight. In that game, the goal came from Patrick Duty of Indiana. Down in the center of the pitch for Notre Dame, that's number 23, Jeffrey Farina. Below number four for IU is Femi Hollinger-Jansen. As we get going, the ball is played and kicked forward. Defender for IU hits it towards midfield. As you see some great aerial play by Notre Dame to start this match. Ball scooped up by IU's goalkeeper, Colin Webb. Webb, just a sophomore. He's from San Diego, California, Rancho Bernardo. Ball taken by number three, that's Connor Klakota for Notre Dame. Ball played up into space, kicked out to touch to Notre Dame. That's number seven for the Irish, Danny Lojek. Lojek with the throw-in, headed down. Hoosiers gonna play it back to number five, Grant Lillard. Keeper Colin Webb playing it up. Folks, joining me in the booth now is Paco Castilla, an assistant coach for the University of St. Francis. Nice play with the right foot off the crossbar. That was number 10 for the Hoosiers, Tanner Thompson. Thompson kind of flicked it with his right foot.
University of Notre Dame.
In goal for the Irish, once again, it is number 13, Chris Hubbard. Ball played right in front. Cleared by number 11 for the Irish, Oliver Harris.
Volunteer assistant, Vern Ginrich.
Paco, some exciting action here to start off this match, and we're just 2 minutes in. Hubbard plays that ball out. Excuse me, that was Webb for Indiana. Cross goes to number two, Billy McConnell. Kind of looking to feed it in front of the net. Cleared by number 11 for Notre Dame, Oliver Harris.
For Indiana University, head coach is Todd Yeagley, assisted by Brian Masonov, also assisted by Kevin Robson, and volunteer assistant is Brad Swenby.
And you hear that, the coach for Indiana, once again, Todd Yeagley, in his fifth season. He was an MAC Player of the Year in his playing days with the Hoosiers. Quite a resume he brings to IU. Bobby Clark in his 14th season with Notre Dame. Grant Lilliard trying to duke his defender. Plays it up to number 11, Cory Thomas. Lillard gets it back. Plays it cross to number 3, Derek Creviston. Ball played to the middle of the pitch. Cleared by number 10, Brandon Aubrey. As that ball is played out to touch, possession to the Irish. Throw-in goes to number 3, Connor Klakota.
This game is just underway, but something that you need to mark on your calendar, August 21st and 22nd. The Shindigz National Soccer Festival fall event is August 21st and 22nd, along with the Bishop Lewis High School Invitational. So it's going to be another fantastic year of incredible soccer in the Fort Wayne area. Now, listen, if you want to be involved.
That was a great feed to number 27, Patrick Hodan.
Soccer Festival. What you need to
just
do is
missed
go
on
to
that connection.
SoccerFestival.com. Let us know that you want to be part, you want to be involved, you want to help in some manner or another, and we will get you involved. There's a lot of people that have worked hard on it for years, and we've decided to make it available and give an opportunity to others that may also want to be involved. So go to nationalsoccerfestival.com.
Ball played out to number 11, Cory Thomas. Tanner Thompson, Phil Fives. Beautiful looking cross headed away by number 7, Danny Lojek for the Irish. Another one centered. Wow, nice right-footed shot by number 9 for IU, Austin Panchot, as he kind of flicked that one behind his back. Ball moves forward. Number 23 for the Irish is Jeffrey Farina. Folks, you heard on the announcement, August 21st and 22nd, the Shindigz National Soccer Festival in Fort Wayne, Indiana. What a great festival it is. It's come to be one of the best in the country at bringing some of the top teams in. Duke, IU, Notre Dame, just to name a few. Nice drag and a nice move by number 14, Phil Fives. Just missed on that shot attempt. So we got a goal kick by the keeper for the Irish. That's Chris Hubbard. Can you hear me? Ball played out to touch. To the Irish, that's number 16, Michael Shipp. Head coach Mitch Ellison from the University of St. Francis, now in the booth. Coach, what do you think so far of the play you see down on the pitch?
Well, I think that IU has had some of the better
George
of the
and Troy.
The better of the play, but
George and Troy, meet your parents now.
Notre Dame is starting to settle down and get the ball, and
George
they've
and
created
Troy.
A couple dangerous chances here in the last
get
5 minutes.
Absolutely, and that last chance was a nice stop by Colin Webb, the keeper for Indiana.
Yeah, it seems IU's having most of their success attacking down the flanks.
As Notre Dame retreats back, number 25 for the Irish, Patrick Brunesky. As that ball's fed up, picked out of the air. Coach's great skill, both of these teams, as you see the air play, just fantastic, whether it's headers or playing it to their foot.
Yeah, when we talk to kids that are saying, you know, I want to play Division I, you know, and we're telling them, you know, your skill, you've got to be able to do that technical stuff under a ton of pressure, and they just demonstrated that. IU did beautifully.
Good defense by number 16 for the Irish. Michael Shipp, as the ball was intended for Femi Hollinger-Jansen. Jansen been extremely busy here. And we are just 8 minutes into this match. Connor Klakota. Ball played up by number 10, Brandon Aubrey. Ball's played out to touch to the Irish. Once again, number 7 is Danny Lojek with throw-in. Ball chested down. As Notre Dame's going to play it out wide to number 16, Michael Shipp. Beautiful feed.
George and Troy, I hope you made it down there to the
keeper Colin Webb grabs it for the Hoosiers.
The south end. By the way, some of the rest of you may want to do that too. You can go down there.
Webb, once again, just a sophomore keeper.
Pork sandwiches.
For Indiana, who once again has 8 national championships under their belt, which is second most in NC2A Division I history.
And thank you once again for
says a lot about that program. Once again, St. Louis has the most national championships, with the last one coming in 1973.
Shindigz National Soccer Festival.
Ball is headed forward and kicked out to touch to Notre Dame. With the throw-in, that's Evan Pankton.
If you have any sort of a special occasion, anything special, you want to have a heck of a party, you want to have a graduation party.
Coach, that was a close play right there. It looked like possession was going to go to IU, but they gave it to Notre Dame.
Call Shindigz. Check on them. Go to shindigz.com. They personalize things just for you. And when you're going to host a party, no matter the occasion, you'll find out the designs and how they can help you put on a heck of a great party, a very enjoyable one. It's where everybody wants to go and shop if you want to put on any sort of a party. You'll notice their booth here on the south end. Shindigz next to them is the Notre Dame Alumni Club. Ooh. Next to them is the IU Alumni Club. Then we have
feed to number 26. The Irish, Mark Gormley, as Gormley flicked it just over the crossbar. What great ball control in traffic for number 26, Gormley.
Three amigos, Grant Fisher, Michael Morrison, Joe Zimmerman.
And folks, we are talking about Shindigz there. They can make fat heads for you, poster cutouts, just about anything you need for your party or for your big event, whether it's senior day in the gym, as we saw last year when Canterbury took on Mount Vernon for girls basketball senior day. They had all kinds of cutouts for the girls and everything provided by Shindigz. You'll definitely want to check them out online. As that was a great opportunity just moments ago for Notre Dame as they got close to Colin Webb, and that ball was just kicked over the crossbar by Gormley. Coach, what great control there by the Irish in traffic. Ball flicked back and headed forward. That's number 3. Connor Klakota. Gormley with a beautiful play. That's number 23 looking for the cross. Jeffrey Farina. Great defense by IU cutting off Farina as it looked like he had the cross. Ball intercepted by 14, Phil Fives. Hollinger Jansen plays it out wide. It's number two, Billy McConnell, who has space. Center of the pitch, Tanner Thompson. Nice feed into the corner, but unable to catch up to it is Phil Fives. Good pressure by the Hoosiers as that ball is cleared and headed forward by Indiana's Derek Creviston. Out to
so
touch
the other
to the Irish.
Help make the Shindigz National Soccer Festival come about. The Journal Gazette Foundation, Pro Resources, REMC, Classic Products, Ian Rowland.
Packed house here at Bishop Darcy Stadium. Estimated 3,000 in attendance. As you see the south end zone complex starting to fill up. Pass kick back to number 25, Patrick Brunesky. Out wide to number 10, Brandon Aubrey. The Irish once again picking up its first national title back in 2013. Last year, knocked out by the eventual national champions, Virginia, in round number three.
Does anybody want a t-shirt?
IU did win this matchup in 2014, 1-0 in Bloomington. Good defense once again by number 25, Patrick Brunesky. Headed away by Farina for the Irish. Farina goes 6'3", 180 out of Wilmette, Illinois. He went to New Trier High School in the Chicagoland area. Ball played out to touch to the Irish. With the throw-in will be number 16, Michael Shipp. Shipp's a junior defender at 5'11", 150 from Lake Forest, Illinois, Lake Forest High School. Chested down by Hollinger Jansen. Cleared by the Irish.
Hollinger Jansen's from the Goshen area.
Hollinger Jansen from Goshen, Indiana?
Yes.
Where he went to Bethany Christian High School, just a junior at 6'1", 174.
All right. He helped them win their last national championship, scoring an important goal in the semifinal game.
What a great program they have there in Goshen, Coach. This year, the Lady Redskins taking on Carroll, I believe it was in a Final Eight matchup.
They did.
With Carroll winning that. Nonetheless, at South Bend St. Joseph High School in South Bend, Indiana, but great soccer in the Goshen area.
Oh, absolutely. They have some very good soccer clubs and just some really great kids up there, too.
Coach, club soccer just huge in Indiana in the Fort Wayne area, the FC United Football Club. And then you also have the Carmel programs down in Indianapolis.
Right. Well, and Fort Wayne United is a merger of Fort Wayne Citadel and Fever 2 years ago, and it's been a great success for the merger.
Coach, before the merger, were you losing players to Indianapolis, or does that still happen?
I think what was happening was there was just too much just too much competition for the same kids, and I think the kids were just getting tired of being recruited So we knew that it was the right thing to do. My assistant, Paco Castillo, is who was the director of coaching for Citadel. He helped to put it together with Bobby Porcinitas, who was the director of coaching for Fever. And the two of them have done an excellent job, you know, creating an environment for kids to come in and succeed and learn and have fun.
And you can find a lot of training going on at the Plex South Complex, just moments away, probably, what, just 4 miles away from the University of St. Francis?
Right. We, yeah, we train every day. I'm the director of goalkeeping for the club, and, you know, the kids are either training or playing. They do get their time off, but we're trying to teach them how to, you know, take care of their bodies.
Beautiful steal there by Tanner Thompson as he's brought back from behind by number 11, Oliver Harris. No foul called on the play. Fed into the box, headed away by the Irish. Busy in the first half has been Brandon Aubrey, number 10, for Notre Dame. Aubrey is a sophomore defender from Plano, Texas. Plano Senior High School. He's 6'3", 173. Coach, you see a bunch of guys down on the pitch, 6'3", or taller. There's some big players. Thompson, left-footed shot, drilled that shot as it was headed away by number 10, Brandon Aubrey. In the background there, you can see Chris Hubbard with a dive attempt. A good thing Aubrey there was there to help him out. Aubrey, the sophomore defender. Coach, obviously Indiana has a great soccer tradition with the second most national titles in NC2A Division I. And it seems like Notre Dame has really picked up their play as of late. They had the Herman Trophy winner in 2006 and won a national championship in 2013.
Well, Bobby Clark is an incredible coach. I met Bobby about 20 years ago when he was the coach up at Dartmouth, and I was coaching ODP up in Maine. And he had a he had a club called Lightning, and they were a dominant club, and so I got to know him through that and ODP, and he's just a quality person.
That ball's played through the end line. We got a goal kick coming up for the Hoosiers. Bobby Clark, once again, his 14th season here, 2014-15 season. He's a graduate of Jordan Hill College, graduated 1967.
Well, and he played nationally somewhere in Europe and, you know, I would assume Scotland, but he's also, he coached the New Zealand national team. He's been the coach of Stanford. He took them to a national tournament game. He's coached a lot of very good teams.
Now doing it for Notre Dame, very prestigious school up in South Bend, Indiana. Now playing in the ACC. Coach, have you had a chance to talk with Bobby Clark about the transition from the Big East to the ACC and what that's meant to this program?
No, we haven't really had an opportunity to talk. But a story that I did hear about him that says something about the way that he runs his program. And, you know, somebody was commenting about a tournament that he was at and asked for the director to come look at the locker room his team was in, and they were saying, you know, they were expecting it to be really dirty, and when they went in, the thing was spotless. And I guess Coach Clark is one of those that tells the players, look, this place is going to be cleaner than when we get here. So that's the kind of things that he cares about. He teaches his players how to be good young men, and not just, you know, he has great soccer players, but he has lots of good. You know,
last shot went wide. That was Jack Griffith, number 6. As kicking it away is Chris Hubbard for the Irish.
He kind of got under that one. That didn't even get out to midfield, and not really sure which way the wind's blowing right now.
Beautiful looking feed, and once again, good defense there by Aubrey, number 10. Wind has died down just a little bit. Earlier in the day, we had about 15-mile-an-hour gusts going from west to east. Wind still heading that direction. probably down the single digits. Beautiful night. So it's about 60 degrees here in Fort Wayne, Indiana. We're about an hour and a half southeast of South Bend, Indiana. About 3.5 hours north of Bloomington.
Welcome to those of you that are just now making it in. We're glad you're here. Thank you for coming to the Shindigz National Soccer Festival and annual spring game between Indiana University and the University of Notre Dame.
Coach, we've had
a number of sponsors that help make this festival, the spring game, as well as in the fall in August, that help make them possible. Some of those, Shindigz, of course, our main sponsor, also Federated Media, the Wilson Foundation, Sally Penn, Brigadoon Fitness, ATM, Burton Vossmeyer and Looney Financial Advisory Group, Steel Dynamics. Shindigz, by the way, is a family-owned company. It focuses on making life more fun, more enjoyable. What they do is they provide unique products you can't find anywhere else. The products are personalized just for you for hosting a party. So when you're going to have any sort of a celebration, a special occasion, shop online to see Shindigz's exclusive design of supplies, decorations. Go to shindigz.com.
That was a great feed there by Patrick Hodan, intended for Jeffrey Farina.
August 21st and 22nd will be the National Soccer Festival, also in coordination with the Bishop Lures High School Invitational Tournament. If you go to nationalsoccerfestival.com, you can go ahead and let us know as far as being involved, get involved in the National Soccer Festival for August.
21:40 left to play here in the first half, and we are scoreless. Coach, that was a beautiful feed that we saw there from Patrick Hodan moments ago. Just missed the header with Jeffrey Farina.
Yeah, I don't think Farina thought it was going to get through.
Coach, on the women's side of things, we've had the Lady Irish here at Bishop Darcy Stadium, most recently taking on Michigan State. I believe that was two springs ago.
We have concessions available for you. Down by the south end of the bleachers is where Don Hall's concessions are. You can get yourself cheeseburgers, hot dogs, pulled pork sandwiches. In the middle of the grandstand area underneath is where the beverages are. You'll find beer and wine there along with soft drinks and water. And by the way, when you do go down to get something to eat, take something with you. Keep the bleachers as clean as you possibly can. When we leave today, we want to make sure they are nice and clean.
Shot goes just right of the goal. That was number 10, Tanner Thompson, who's been busy offensively for the Hoosiers. Coach, but what went into bringing such great caliber men's soccer here to Bishop Darcy Stadium? Have you ever remembered such a matchup here at Bishop Darcy?
Oh, never. I think it's the bad, undependable weather of spring.
Here, you know, with the
this
artificial
is the best
turf.
Weather they've ever had.
And it is beautiful, 60 degrees out here in Fort Wayne. Coach, this is the last year of this turf right here, which is a sport turf, a very, very fast surface with such short blades. The new next turf that will be installed here, well, within a week, a little bit longer of a blade of grass.
Yeah, it'll be the newer kind of turf. I mean, it's 11 years old. We play a number of schools that have that kind of turf, and, you know, my players, enjoy it. You know, Spring Arbor has a field that's like that. It's very good.
Do you feel like this is the fastest surface you guys will play on all year?
Oh, no. I think there's other surfaces that are, you know, just as fast. Maybe, you know, not faster.
Goal kick by the Irish. That one lands at the opposite 40. Once again, good air play. Playing to foot. That's number 27, Patrick Hodan. Cleared by number 5 for the Hoosiers, Grant Lilliard. Nicely done by Tanner Thompson. So he's going to cross it over to number two, Billy McConnell. Hoosiers setting up. Just missed connection there as the turnover goes to Notre Dame. Connor Klokota. So that ball is going to be chased down by the keeper, Colin Webb. Taken by number 11, Oliver Harris.
You can see the way that Notre Dame is defending. They're two blocks of four, so we call that a block of eight, with their two forwards kind of hanging up there and making things predictable. So it's kind of neat watching the way they set up their defense.
Coach, how is that different from what we're seeing from IU? It looks like they constantly have two defenders back.
Right.
Throw in by number 16, Michael Shipp. Header towards the center of the pitch by Jeffrey Farina. That was number three, Connor Klokota, as it's played out to touch. To the Hoosiers. Throw in goes to Tanner Thompson, cleared by number 14, Phil Fives. Controlled by the Irish. Backpedaling is 27, Patrick Hodan. Number 11 wearing the captain's sleeve is Oliver Harris. Number 3 also a captain, Klokota. That ball's taken away by the Hoosiers. Number 9, Austin Panchot. That was Fives. Thompson in the mix, and we've got our first player down on the pitch. That's the Irish, number 3, Derek Creviston. Coach, this Shindigz National Soccer Festival really has built into something special. I know that you've been a part of it, both as a coach. But just talk about what that's meant to the Fort Wayne area.
Oh, I think it's incredible. When you look at the one that they brought in the fall, I mean, we've seen, you'd mentioned before, just Notre Dame and IU, but you've had Duke, you've had St. John's, you've had Kentucky, Michigan, Michigan State. Those are incredible programs. And I remember a few years ago, in the very beginning, Duke came and Duke was playing St. John and Rutgers, and Duke was winning 1-0 late in the game, and Rutgers came back to win 2-1, and the Duke coach took his team out and ran them for three hours. So the next day they go out and they beat IPFW 8-0.
Imagine that. Good lesson learned there. But, yeah, always a great environment, whether it's over there at IPFW, at the Fort Wayne Soccer Club, and here now at Bishop Darcy Stadium. Coach, do they plan on playing more games here at Darcy Stadium?
Oh, absolutely. They and I've already heard from the director, they're saying that this is the best facility they've played in Fort Wayne now. You know, they played at the Hefner Fields, they've played at the Sport Club, and they're going, you know what, they have locker rooms that are separate. They have enough room that, you know, we've got training rooms, so we took care of those needs for them. There's nothing like our stadium in town, this height, you know.
Absolutely.
So,
as we are high above the pitch here, that was Danny Lojek, number 7, that was taken down to the pitch by Hollander Jansen. Jansen in control, dribbling up the center of the pitch. Nice feed to number 11, Cory Thomas. Thomas, the ball is taken away by number 7, Lojek. Into space, tracked down by number 10, Tanner Thompson. Thompson been extremely busy for the Hoosiers, looking for a cross, a beautiful feed. Ooh, just misconnected there with Thompson. Coach, were you surprised that number 11 for IU didn't take a shot? That was Cory Thomas.
I'm always surprised when players don't take shots.
Ball played in front of the goal. Hubbard's out off his line to snag it out of the air. Great play by the keeper, Chris Hubbard. Coach, always a scary moment when you come off the line like that, but he corralled it and took care of it.
Well, he's a big kid. I was standing down there watching him warm up, and he's probably more intimidating to coming out in a ball like that. He's not worried as much about getting hurt. Other people are.
Chris Hubbard is a sophomore keeper at 6'4", 205. He's from Louisville, Kentucky, Trinity High School. And coming off the pitch is number 7 for the Irish, Danny Lojek, and number 9 for IU, Austin Panchot. Ball kicked up, number 25 for Notre Dame, Berneski. Another player down, and Coach, we might have our first foul.
No, I think we've had a few fouls. I think it wasn't sure if he might have carded him, but.
Free kick is for number 5. Grant Lillard gets it right back. Ball taken by Connor Klakota. They got space. He has a man right to his left. Feed does go to number 15. Shot is headed away. Beautiful play by IU number 3. Derek Creviston. Scary situation there, Coach,
yeah,
as the keeper, Colin Webb, was nowhere to be found.
Yeah, that was a 5-on-3. It was an incredible counter.
Derek Creviston once again.
We have some subs in the game for Indiana University. Number 27, Brad Shaw, and number 8, Michael Report, both went in. They replaced 11, Cory Thomas, and number 9, Austin Panchot.
Derek Creviston, just a redshirt sophomore defender at 6'1", 180 from Atlanta, Georgia.
Notre Dame, number 6, Max Lakowecki, and number 17, John Gallagher. They replaced Danny Lojek, number 7, and number 26, Mark Gormley.
So Brad Shaw had that pass taken away. Another whistle blows, and possession will go to the Hoosiers. Tanner Thompson quick with it, trying to catch the Irish napping.
Yeah, I think that pass that you were talking about, if he had just held it a second longer and let the IU runner come in behind the defender, that space was open for him to play it. Just a premature pass.
Kicked out to touch to the Hoosiers.
Zip down underneath the grandstand. You can get yourself a beverage, beer, wine, soft drinks, water available at the south end of the grandstand. You'll find Don Hall's concession down there. Cheeseburgers, hot dogs, pulled pork sandwiches. They're one of our sponsors. Some of our other sponsors, Burton Vossmeyer and Looney Financial Advisory Group, the Journal Gazette Foundation, Pro Resources, Alco, Beverage Company. Remember, we do have beer and wine. Also, Classic Products. Individuals like Ian Rowland, Sally Penn.
Ooh.
Brigadoon Fitness is one, so is Steel Dynamics, New Image Printing, Star Technology, and our main one, of course, Shindigz. Shindigz.com, go check them out. Anything that you need to do as far as party supplies, having any sort of a celebration, check with Shindigz and you'll find out how to make it better.
Ball played out to touch to the Hoosiers. Billy McConnell with the throw-in gets it up to Hollander Jansen. Tightly guarded by number 15, Evan Pinkton.
You youngsters are going to be participating in our halftime competition and festivities. Make your way now to the designated area. All of you that have volunteered, as a matter of fact, asked and said, please, can I be involved? Make your way to the designated area, because pretty soon, at halftime, you're going to be out there competing.
Chris Hubbard with the goal kick. Coach, what a shot there by Hollinger Jansen. Just missed the left post.
On soccer skills. Soccer skills relay competition.
This ball is played back to the Irish, number six, Max Lachowski. Just 9 minutes and 45 seconds left to play here in the first half. Coach, this first match earlier in the fall went to IU 1-0. You surprised that we're scoreless with 9 minutes left to play here in the first half?
No, these teams are both so well-trained and, you know, to try to break down the other team, even though, like, it seems a couple times you've seen, like, IU's gotten in and Notre Dame's gotten in, they couldn't put that final, you know, that final touch in behind. It's so difficult. So
that was a great one touch there by number 16, Michael Shipp, but a great play by number 5 for IU, Grant Lilliard, to knock it away. Extremely skilled are these two teams, routinely in the top 10 in the NC2A Division 1. Last year, Notre Dame was number one in the country when IU handed them the 1-0 loss. IU ranked number 8 in the country at the time. Coach, what kind of response did you get from some of the young kids at the Fort Wayne United Football Club when you told them, hey, we're going to have the 2012 National Champs and 2013 National Champs playing right here in Fort Wayne?
Can we get some tickets?
And the community has responded, Coach. There is a great showing here at Darcy Stadium. Looks like estimated 3,000 fans.
Yeah, for you and I, it's a matter of, you know, we see football fills the stands like this. And so how does it compare to a football game, you know? That's the incredible part. You know, people are playing soccer out here.
And two great teams, as coming up with it is number 14, Phil Vives. Vives seems like a tenacious player for the Hoosiers, Coach.
Yeah, he's very good. He was not going to be denied there.
He's a junior defender from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, North Allegheny High School. With the corner kick, it's going to be number 10, Tanner Thompson. Said his name a lot today. He's a sophomore midfielder, 5'7", 150, from Loomis, California, Granite Bay High School. Low liner from the corner. Coach, oftentimes you'll see a low liner like that. Some people like to loft it in the air and try to bend it. Is that just a call by the coach there? Or?
No, usually at this level, it's a call by the players. They're letting each other know where the ball's going. You know, they have different runs that are taking place, and so everybody's expected to make their run. And then the guy playing the ball in, he gets to play the ball where he wants.
With the throw in is number 14, Fives.
Down in our end zone seat, we want to thank all of the organizations that have helped support Soccer Festival by occupying those end zone seats. Of course, at the far east end, that's where you'll find the three amigos. They promised that they would do a dance for you later.
That was Phil Fives with the bender.
They are led by Brad Fisher, Michael Morrissey, and Joe Zimmerman. And if you remember the movie Three Amigos, you ought to see these guys all dressed up on horseback and doing that wonderful dance moves. And believe me, they are very capable of something.
Ball played up.
Say hi to those guys. Next to them, you have Coldwell Banker. Now, Coldwell Banker, I think one of the rules, if you're going to be part of Coldwell Banker, you probably are going to have to be involved in soccer, because John Bellio and Jerry Jenkins are two guys that have been involved in soccer for years and years. And so you can pretty well count on the fact that if there's something going on, they're going to be around to help support it. So thank you to Coldwell Banker. Also, next to them, we have Three Rivers Federal Credit Union. Thanks to Three Rivers, as well as Andrew Krause. Next to them, of course, the Indiana University Alumni Club. Thanks, guys, for being here. And next to them is the Notre Dame Alumni Club. I don't know if Tom Skiba made it or not, but welcome to them. And, of course, next to them is the Shindigs booth. the Shindigz National Soccer Festival. That's what we call it. You go to shindigz.com and you can learn more about everything that they offer. You want to do any sort of a celebration, check with them. Shindigz.com.
Coach, on that last shot on goal there by the Hoosiers, looked like that ball for sure was going over the crossbar, and the English just brought it right back down to where Chris Hubbard made the save. Very, very impressive. Is that what you kind of find as the divisions get a little bit higher and the play a little bit greater? I mean, these guys with some fantastic skills.
No, that ball actually came off a defender's foot, and so the defender got underneath it, and that ball actually got the topspin put on it because of it. So, that's lucky.
And, Coach, there are some tight quarters here with the fence and the sidelines.
Well, I'm concerned about the pond. You know, our lake is big enough where once the ball goes in, we never know where the ball's going to go.
Hopefully it retreats back to the shoreline. Yep. Another one kicked out to touch. Coach, is that a problem for the players when you have those tight quarters for the corner kicks?
I don't think so.
Is it just a different way of setting up? Or?
If you need to take a lot of steps to kick a ball, there's something wrong with your technique. You know how, like, when you watch, they talk about quarterback throw short and compact versus the guy who takes the real long windup? That's the same thing with kicks.
Like a Byron Leftwich or...
Yeah. Or even they were talking about Jameis Winston. That is...
with the big windup?
Was a little too big, you know, or, you know...
Little exaggerated arm motion, I guess you could say.
Thank you. I don't coach football.
Or a different kind of football, right, Coach?
Right,
with
exactly.
An FUT. Down to the pitch was Hollinger Jansen.
Yeah, sometimes you wonder if they're just getting back at somebody.
Coach, what have you been most impressed with so far here in the first half?
Just the technical ability of the players, you know, their composure under pressure.
At halftime, we are going to have a special competition, but there's still time for you to get down to the concession stands. Don Hall's, as well as the beverage concession stand right under the grandstands.
Fort Wayne media in full force as we have Dean Pantazzi down on the pitch. We've seen all three of our TV stations here at Bishop Darcy Stadium covering this great exhibition soccer match between the 2012 national champs, IU, and 2013 national champs, Notre Dame. As that ball is going to be played through the end line, goal kick coming up for the Hoosiers.
You know, Paco taught me something a long time ago, and he said, skill is being able to use your technical ability under pressure. You know, a lot of players have technical ability, but once you put somebody on their back and say, okay, now can you juggle the ball five times with somebody pulling on you, you know, and that's what you're seeing here, a lot of very skillful players.
Coach, can that be taught as far as that mental mindset under pressure to be able to pull off those techniques? I mean, obviously muscle memory is just a matter of continually doing something, but, you know, from a mental aspect?
You know, I think from the coaching standpoint you're talking about, you know, the kids have to have the technique, and, you know, that could be a coach taught thing, but the players have to learn it as well. But I think coaches have to give their kids, put them in the environment.
Hollinger Jansen took that deflection and threw it right over the crossbar. Nice opportunity there for IU.
But it has to be created in the environment in the training session.
We have 50 seconds remaining here in the first half. Scoreless at Bishop Darcy Stadium, Notre Dame and IU. Hubbard with the big kick. 50-50 taken.
When you do go down to concessions.
By number five, Grant Lilly.
Help everybody out. Make sure that you take something along and throw it in the trash. Keep the bleachers clean, if you would, please.
25 seconds.
Going down, carry a little something, not a problem.
20 seconds left. Free kick fed towards the goal. Picked out of the air by number 23 for the Irish, Jeffrey Farina.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, four, three, two, one.
Folks, that'll do it here for the first half. We're going to take a break in the booth, and we will be back with you right before the start of half number two. Welcome back, everyone, to Bishop Darcy Stadium for this 2015 exhibition match between the Indiana Hoosiers, winners of 8 national championships, the last one coming in 2012, taking on the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, the 2013 national champions, their first in the program's history. Notre Dame coached by the legendary Bobby Clark. Clark in his 14th season with the Irish. Todd Yeagley, the coach at Indiana. Coach Yeagley is in his 5th season with IU. Coach Yeagley was a player for Indiana, where he was named the Missouri Athletic Club National Player of the Year in 1994. He remains third on IU's career assist list with 40 and shares the Big Ten single season assist record with 14. He recorded those 14 assists back in 1993. After his playing days at Indiana, Yeagley also enjoyed a successful 7-year professional career in Major League Soccer with the Columbus Crew. Columbus passed the MLS playoffs.
We are ready for some more soccer.
In 5 of Yeagley's 7 seasons.
In just a few moments. There is one thing, though, I want to make sure and share with all of you folks. You know, we do have some good soccer here in the Fort Wayne area. We have some good players that have come out of the Fort Wayne area to play. We have one, DeMarcus Beasley, that has gone on to play on the national team. He was in 4 World Cups. And not only was he on the team, he played in 4 World Cups. We have some pretty decent referees out here, too. I mentioned to you the center referee is Andrew Bigelow. Andrew has risen to the point where he is now a professional level referee. He has done some MLS games. He's the man in the center. On the far side, you have Doug Ferguson, and on the near side, you have Ben Trevino, and the fourth official is Vlade Javevsky. All of whom have helped Biggs become a darn good referee.
So that's Chris Hubbard, the keeper for Notre Dame, with the goal kick. Hubbard, once again, only a sophomore.
There's quite a lineup there at the Hall's concession stand, but when you get a chance, check it out. Go back down there. As long as they don't run out, we got hot dogs, burgers, pulled pork sandwiches, and then, of course, the concession stand under the grandstand, beer, wine, soft drinks, water. So enjoy, and make sure that whatever you do, when you do go down someplace to get something, make sure you take something along with you to throw in the trash. Keep the stands as clean as we possibly can. We really appreciate it. To put this on, there are a lot of sponsors that have been part of it. Of course, we do want to thank St. Francis University, because we are playing here on their field. We also want to thank Shindigz, our main sponsor, Shindigz National Soccer Festival. Go to shindigz.com to check them out. Also, the General Gazette Foundation, Pro Resources, REMC, Classic Products, individuals like Ian Rowland and Sally Penn, the Wilson Foundation, Federated Media, Brigadoon Fitness, Alco, Burton Bossmeyer Looney Financial Advisory Group, ATM, as well as Star Technologies. Star Technologies up in Waterloo, Indiana. New Image Printing. The Indy 11 is the pro team that's down in Indianapolis. And Parkview Sports Medicine. They've all done a great deal to help support this. If you'd like to become more involved in the National Soccer Festival, go to nationalsoccerfestival.com. and put your voice in there, your name in there, that you would like to be part of the festival, you would like to help out in some manner or another. There are a lot of different things you could become involved in, so check it out.
42 minutes and 15 seconds left to play here in the second half, and we are scoreless in half number two. Indiana and Notre Dame in the booth with me is Paco Castilla, an assistant coach at the University of St. Francis for Mitch Ellison. Paco, one of the things that really surprised me there in the first half was I believe we only had one corner kick. Does that surprise you in a game like this?
Well, yeah, I mean, and there's been quite a bit of attacking, so yeah, it is surprising.
Center of the pitch for IU, that's number 24, Trevor Swartz. As we see some new, fresh faces out on the pitch here in the second half. Friendly exhibition here in 2015. During the regular season, it was Indiana taking this match 1-0 over the Fighting Irish in Bloomington. Fed towards the center of the pitch, right through the legs of Hollinger Jansen. Shot on goal is taken by the keeper, number 13, Chris Hubbard. Hubbard once again goes 6'4", 205, the sophomore keeper. Great sophomore class here at Notre Dame. And excuse me, looks like we had a new keeper. That's Brian Talcutt, number 30. And for IU, it's still number 32, Colin Webb. Talcutt goes 6'2", 170. He's from Omaha, Nebraska, Milliard North High School. Great one-touch passing there as the ball makes its way up to number 17, John Gallagher. Shot goes wide left. Coach, what do you think about that sequence right there? It's a bunch of one-touches.
That was good combination down the middle and then open it up wide. That's a driven ball across the mouth of the goal, expecting a backside run. A little late, they got their...
Lineup here for the second half. Out on the field for University of Notre Dame, number 3 is Connor Klekova. Number 6, Max Lakowecki. 10 is Brandon Aubrey. 15 is Evan Pankin. 16, Michael Shipp. 17, John Gallagher. 20 is Blake Towns. 23, Jeffrey Farina. 25, Patrick Bernetsky. 27 is Patrick Hodine. And the goal for the Irish, Ryan Talcott, number 30. For the Indiana University Hoosiers, number 3, Derek Creviston. 4 is Femi Hollinger Jansen. 5 is Grant Lillard. 7, Max Foldesi. 9 is Austin Panchot. 10 is Tanner Thompson. 11, Cory Thomas. 14, Phil Fives. 20, Tim Mayle. 24, Trevor Schwartz. And still in goal, Colin Webb, number 32.
That ball is kicked out to touch to the Irish. That's Michael Shipp, number 16, with the throw-in. Chested down, flicked in the air. Header goes out towards number 14 for IU, Phil Fives. Fives very busy in the first half. He, along with Tanner Thompson and Femi Hollinger Jansen, had great halves for the Hoosiers. Of course, Hollinger Jansen is from nearby Goshen, Indiana.
Yeah, he came out of Northridge High School. Very good player. He's got some time starting as early as a freshman. He came in and started playing for IU, getting some good minutes.
Talk about Northridge out of the Goshen area. We know Goshen's, the Redskins are very good as well. Coach, would you consider maybe three of the top areas in the state of Indiana being Indy, Goshen, and Fort Wayne, or is there another area I'm missing?
Well, I think the Evansville area also could be included in there. But yeah, I mean, I think Fort Wayne's done a good job developing some players. And of course, Indianapolis, with the numbers that they have to work with, is always good competition there.
Once again, Hollinger Jansen is just a junior at 6'174" from Goshen, Indiana. Number 3 for the Hoosiers, Derek Creviston, plays back to Grant Lillard. He's going to send it back to the keeper, Colin Webb. Colin Webb just a sophomore for IU. Coach, we've called out a lot of sophomores for each of these teams. I got to believe that their high competitive level is going to remain here in the years to come.
You know, when you talk about these two programs, it's, you know, when you talk about good programs, they don't go out recruiting, they reload. You know, they just bring in player after player, and you got to be performing at a top level. So yeah, even sophomores, there's high expectations for them when they come into these programs.
And IU's been doing it for years, Coach. They won their first national title in 1982. They just keep reloading and reloading and reloading. It's been to the tune now of about 30 straight years of reloading, really even beyond that.
Right, it's a great tradition that, you know, Coach Yeagley has developed there and built, and the program's been, you know, solid ever since. So his son taking over is just helping the cause a little more. So yeah, their tradition keeps on going.
Coach, their first Herman Trophy winner was Angelo DiBernardo, and I had a chance to cover his daughter Vanessa out of the Naperville area. She went on to play at Illinois, where she was one of the top players in the Big Ten.
Correct. They have they have a great tradition. They have a number of players playing for the, you know, MLS professionally, and oh my goodness, that's a
just over the crossbar. What a shot by number 27, Patrick Hodan. Coach, he just missed it there.
Yeah, I think he could have done a little better with that. I think he was trying to chip the goalie, and unfortunately, he just missed it, getting it under the bar.
That was very close. He probably missed it by maybe 2 feet.
Yes. It looked like it was miscommunication between the two Indiana Central defenders, and the ball got through there.
Goal kick is off. 50-50 taken by the Irish, number 27, Patrick Hodan. As you see, number 5 just shielding the Notre Dame player. That is Grant Lilliard, number 5. Nice feed. And a beautiful play by number 9 for the Hoosiers, Austin Panchot. Coach, if Austin doesn't get a foot on it there, that might be a goal for number 6 for Notre Dame, Max Lakowecki.
Yeah, I think it was a no-look pass from that, I believe it was one of the forwards for Notre Dame. And it just a little late, or IU actually defenders got there a little early.
Notre Dame keeping possession here, as that was cleared by the Hoosiers, number 20, Tim Mell. We are 10 minutes into the second half here, still scoreless. Ball headed out. Number 10 is Tanner Thompson for the Hoosiers. Staying busy here in the second half as well. And a great play by Max Lakowicki. Left-footed cross does make its way. And that's a goal by number 27, Patrick Hodan. What a great feed. And eventually that ball made its way to Hodan for the goal.
And we have a goal for the University of Notre Dame.
And that's what happens when you have a
number 27, Patrick Hodan.
Those driven crosses that we were talking about earlier, number 6, Max Lakowicki bringing it across, and then having, you know, Trevor just mishit that. Trevor Schwartz for IU mishit it, and Notre Dame player there obviously ready to take that mistake and put it back in the net.
And Coach, what a lesson to be learned there, to never give up on it, because I think for a second there, Hodan was wondering if that ball was going to make its way to him, and he was right in position when it did.
As we said before, I mean, we had the dangerous cross driven ball to the backside, and that's the expectation, that you have that backside runner. And luckily for Notre Dame, he stayed with it.
Now the Irish with a 1-0 lead here. What's the? Are you playing defense now? If you're the Fighting Irish, and obviously IU is going to be as offensive as.
That goal for Notre Dame. Max Lakowicki was on the assist. He was on the cross, and Patrick Codam's the one that put it in. Number 27.
So, well, if you're Notre Dame, do you stay on the defensive here?
Well, I think in a preseason game, I think coaches want to see more of what their team can do. So I think they're playing straight up with one another right now. I don't think anybody's really playing for the score per se. I know everybody wants to win, but I think coaches are here to see what they have for the next fall. So I look for them to keep playing the way they've been playing.
Both teams losing their seniors from the fall season here. Looking to see who's going to step up, and that's number 4, Hollinger Jansen, who plays it back. Ooh, what a great shot! And deflected in by number 11, Cory Thomas. Coach, that was Tanner Thompson who let it rip.
Number 11, Cory Thomas.
Yeah, the goalie had a little difficult time with that ball. I think it was knuckled.
Saved by the Irish keeper. But Cory was right there to put that rebound in. And we are tied up just that quickly.
Wow, Coach, and that was quick. 33-34. Now we have 32-12 left to play, so a difference of about a minute. And once again, Cory Thomas not giving up on the play.
That was Tanner Thompson. And then the rebound, and Cory Thomas was right there to put it in.
No doubt about it. Tanner Thompson's been fantastic in this match as well. But I'm sure that's another great lesson to be learned, just trailing the play there. It was a great save by the keeper, Brian Talcott, for Notre Dame. But that shot was so hard that it deflected off him, didn't deflect too far, where number 11, Cory Thomas, was able to knock it in. Great feed.
It's great to see well-coached teams, because they create those opportunities, and the follow-up are always, the following players always following the ball. So, you know, they have a good nose for the goal. So there, you can see it right there. Both teams have it with in them.
So exciting play here. 13 minutes into the second half, we get our first goal. And the PA announcer
Uniform
is
clear,
right.
Blue sky,
0-0.
Sunshine, not too hot, not too cold, no snow,
good job of
shielding
there. Great job by IU keeping that ball in play as it was right on the touchline.
Between Indiana University and the University of Notre Dame, I tell you, this is great stuff. By the way, if it still is tied at the end of the game, we're going to 2 10-minute overtime periods. So you folks really get an opportunity to see soccer today.
2 overtime periods. I'm wondering if there would be PKs after that, or is it a golden... What do they call the golden goal there, Coach?
Yeah, I believe they... If they're tied after the first 5, they go to, after the overtimes, they go into the penalty kicks. Yes, you're correct.
We are inside 30 minutes to play, 29:55 remaining in the second half as it's played out to touch to the Hoosiers. Number 24 with the throw in, Trevor Swartz. Another nice feed into space. Corralling is Phil Fives. Cross made its way to Thomas, but cleared by the Irish. Headers flick forward as well, retreating back for the Hoosiers, Derek Creviston. Tim Mell up to number 9, Austin Panchot. Panchot doing a great job of taking that ball out of the air. Back to Tanner Thompson. You know, of all the players down on the pitch, Tanner Thompson's the first one that his name, that number, really sticks out because he's been so involved here in this match. Entering the match is number 24.
And we have a substitution for Notre Dame, number 24. Mark Michu is in. 23, Jeffrey Farina. Oh, he's still in. Let's see who came off there.
Looks like coming off the pitch was number 16 for the Irish, Michael Shipp.
Off the field now was number 16, Michael Shipp for the Irish.
As it's played out to touch to the Hoosiers, Phil Fives once again with the throw in as Thomas plays it back to Thompson. Thomas and Thompson seem to have a little rapport going here. As the Hoosiers last year in conference play, competing in the Big Ten, were 3-3-2, 12-5-5 overall. Just kind of shows you some of the competitiveness you find in the Big Ten. As the Hoosiers were 500.
The Big Ten is very competitive.
Coach Todd Yeagley, his first year at Wisconsin in 2009, where his team went 7-9-2 overall and 3-3 in the Big Ten. I got to believe it was an easy decision for him to leave Wisconsin and come back home to Indiana.
Oh, yeah. Like I said, the tradition that they have at IU is great. And I think, you know what, something that his father built, I think he was just proud to go ahead and follow in the footsteps.
And a great player he was at IU as well, playing from 1991 to 1994.
Yeah, he had a pretty decent career playing even up to the national team. I mean, he's got some experience behind him.
Playing with the Columbus Crew?
Yes, sir.
They won the Lamar Hunt U.S. Open Cup in 2002.
Him as well as his assistant ended up playing, Coach Masonoff, ended up playing playing for the Crew, which were they were also teammates at IU, by the way.
Once again, great ball movement as that ball was kicked away. I believe that was number 25 for the Irish, Patrick Brunesky. Still, Austin Panchot, Tanner Thompson, Cory Thomas really doing a good job of finding each other in tight quarters. And Coach, one of the things that we're seeing here is these passes aren't hitting a foot and then deflecting off. I mean, it stays to these players' feet.
That is correct. Like Coach Allison said earlier, the technical piece has got to be at this Division I level, and they're showing it. They're showing a very good technical level.
Looks like Kyle Sparks will enter the game for Austin Panchot, who we were just talking about moments ago.
Tell you what, since the goal was scored, it seems like IU's been taking a little bit, taking it to Notre Dame, and the momentum has gone their way.
I'd agree, Coach. It seems like the possession is definitely in favor of IU since Notre Dame got that first goal with 33-34 left to play here in the half. We're at 25-35 now left to play. As that ball is headed down, number 7 for IU, Matt Foldsey. Chested down by number 6, Max Lakowecki. Lakowecki had the assist on that goal for Notre Dame.
We just have a substitution for Indiana University. Now on the field for them is number 21, Kyle Sparks. He replaced Austin Panchot, number 9.
Number 27, a great play into space. The cross thwarted by number 24, Indiana, Tim Mell. Once again, Coach, is that always kind of the goal when you're attacking there, is to get the ball in the corner and try to get that cross off?
Well, that's what the defense has given them. I mean, the Indiana defense is collapsing very well towards the middle there. You know, we started on the left side for Notre Dame, and that ball ended up all the way on the right. And like we said, those driven balls across, and that's what's been given by the IU defense.
Cory Thomas was taken down to the pitch. Now the ball goes back to Thompson, taken away by number 17 from behind John Gallagher. ...24-14 left here in the second half as we are knotted at 1 apiece. Ball headed forward and out to touch to the Irish. It's number 6, Max Lakowecki. Lakowecki is a senior defender from Evansville, Indiana, Wrights Memorial. Number clock is stopped here at 23:42. John Gallagher trying to put some pressure on the IU defenders. Coach is at a forward's job, too, just to make sure those defenders don't maybe get off as clean of a kick or to make them have to work just a little bit.
Correct. I can't see the number, but, yeah, the forward, all he does is kind of guide the defender to an area so it can make it predictable for the rest of your teammates to shift that way and defend us as part of their defending shape.
So John Gallagher can kind of push a defender one way or another. That's going to help his team out in the midfield.
Correct. It gives the rest of the team an idea of which way to shift.
Now it's Hunter Jansen.
Fami's doing it on the other side, yes. When you start pressuring, both teams are very low risk. They don't take risk in the back. And this is why it has become a midfield game. I mean, you know, like you were saying, you don't see too many corners. The possession is mainly in the midfield. Yes, we get opportunities, but not many just errant shots that are going over the goal.
And once again, that just also speaks to the skill level, coach, to where they know not to let that ball roll through the end line, give up that corner kick. I mean, would you say in NC2A Division I that most goals are scored off a dead ball?
In any soccer, dead ball situations are very dangerous.
Yeah.
A high percentage of goals are scored on set pieces.
Once again, out to touch to the Irish here. Luckwicky able to get it away. That was Thomas down there too. You are seeing some great play here on the pitch, midfield. Now Hollinger Jansen comes up with it. Has it taken away by number 20, Blake Towns. Out to touch this time to the Hoosiers.
Yes, the double team is the one that's created the opportunity for IU there. The work rate. Just work rate between Fami and his teammate.
Coach, a lot of times when you look at the D1 facilities, these guys all have natural grass surfaces. How often do you think a team like IU or Notre Dame gets to play on an artificial surface?
You know, at this moment, I really haven't researched it, and I couldn't tell you if any of the I believe Michigan is one of them that has turf, but not too many. A lot of them have. And the Big Ten have the natural grass.
One touch into space. Keeping it alive there was Thomas. And coach, did number 6 down there, Lekaweki, did he do a good job there of kind of not forcing that ball and let Thomas come up? He kicked it out to touch, but he didn't give up that corner kick.
That's correct. That's...
Oh, we got a yellow card going to be called on number 15, Evan Pankton.
Yeah, he came a little late on that tackle, and I think the referee is, there he goes. He comes back and apologizes.
Yeah.
They understand this is only a friendly, and we need to keep, the safety of the players should be the priority.
20 minutes and 6 seconds left to play here. That was number 20, Tim Mell, along with number 15, Evan Pankton. And as Coach said, just great sportsmanship. But we see that a lot here at Darcy Stadium, whether it's the University of St. Francis and Crossroads League play. Coach, it really doesn't matter what division you're at. Very competitive soccer being played here at Darcy Stadium.
Yes, you get that. Yeah, you get that. I mean, you get into the heat of the game, and we're all competitive. I mean, even as coaches. But I think we got to understand that, you know, a lot of us, especially as players, these guys are looking at this as a preseason game and need to understand to keep each other safe, I guess.
Coach, there was a big collision. That was Derek Creviston, number 3 from IU there, just hard nose going after the ball.
It was a good challenge. I mean, a good 50-50 ball, and, you know, these guys are great athletes, so.
Nice.
That was a little chippy there. I think he came a little high with that tackle.
And the card's going to be pulled on number 20, Tim Mell, for Indiana. Coach Mell nearly was able to get a shot off there. I thought it was a great pass back to number 10, but then he draws the yellow.
Yes, when he took that long touch, you know, players have a tendency of stretching their foot when that's a very dangerous play when somebody's swinging through, because if you're high enough, you know, you can injure somebody that way. And that's exactly why he got the yellow.
Coach, we saw that at St. Francis this year with our senior captain, Jason Walcutt, where he went up for a ball and the defender came in and took out his knee, and it was a season-ending injury.
Yeah, I like to see,
That was so good, we did have another sub. 22 for Indiana University, Michael Galullo. He's in for number 4, Femi Hollier Jensen.
But yeah, Coach, going back to that play, what do you like to see on the pitch?
Oh, I think IU has taken it to Notre Dame. There's, like I said, it's in the last goal, and Notre Dame's getting a bit frustrated. But they're playing more of a direct game, trying to hit the targets, their forwards up front, and play off of them. But IU's possessing the ball a little better.
That last shot went wide left. It was number 24, Mark Michoud for the Irish. Michoud, a sophomore defender at 6'1", 170, from Knoxville, Tennessee. Knoxville Catholic. His brother, Luke Michoud, also on the team. He's a senior defender during the 2014 season. Great soccer in Tennessee as well. As it's a sport that's really picking up here in the United States, people are starting to find that it's a safe sport for the kids to play, as it's played up to number 17, John Gallagher, trying to turn the corner as Gallagher, and he does it. Nice deke move there, but knocked away by number 3, Derek Creviston.
I think it just got away from him a little bit. I think he crossed the end line, so we're getting a goal kick.
Coach, do you feel like the IU defender knew that he had help and knew that he was kind of going beyond the side post of the goal there, kind of let him just go?
Once he got beat, I don't think he wanted to commit a foul. It's inside the 18. You don't want to give up a penalty that way.
Yeah.
You got to make a recover run, if anything, and allow your defense to play it out.
That cross is kept in by number 24 for IU, Trevor Schwartz. Is coming up the pitch. Nice job of clearing there as that ball was deflected by number 5, Grant Lilliard. Coach, you saw in that last attempt there, the Notre Dame offensive player getting in front of, I believe it was number 27, Patrick Hodan. Looked like he was trying to clear some space, but then the IU defender, number 5, Lilliard, stepped up big, knocking it away.
Yeah, IU's defense is very compact, and so there. Oh.
Beautiful shot, and a great save by Colin Webb, who had to sprawl out to his left and got it with his left hand. We do have a corner kick coming up. That was number 17, I believe, John Gallagher, with a shot on goal.
That was a great individual turn there, the way he received the ball, understood there was nobody behind him, and let the ball run across his body and just take a crank at the goal there.
Patrick Hodan with the left-footed corner as it's knocked away by number 24, Trevor Schwartz. Coach, the first corner we saw was more of a low-line drive. That one had a little bit more loft on it, but a lot of steam coming in there, as you saw it kind of ricochet between two Notre Dame players off the head.
There's still an opportunity, I believe, down at under the grandstand, the concession stand for beer, wine, soft drinks, water. And when you go down for something, go ahead and take along some trash. There you go, just like that guy is. Good for you. Let's hear it, IU fan. Yeah.
15:05.
Help keep the bleachers clean. We thank you for that. We seriously do.
15:05.
We'd also like to thank some others. Don Hall's Restaurant, who's taking care of the concession stand, and also they are the caterer for many of those that are in the end zone, as far as those end zone suites. Also thank Indy 11. It's the pro team that's down in Indianapolis. ATM, Burton Bossmeyer and Looney Financial Advisory Group, Brigadoon Fitness, Star Technologies, Parkview Sports Medicine. Down here in the end zone suites, there's just one group that you need to say hi to some of them, and that's the one headed up by the three amigos. I've looked over there and I don't see any of them in their sombreros, but I'm sure they have them probably in their car. That'd be Brad Fisher, Michael Morrissey, and Joe Zimmerman.
That was Jeffrey Farina with the cross. Good looking cross, missed his Irish teammate. As Notre Dame once again on the offensive. Big shot by number three, Connor Klakota.
The pressure in there, IU committing the turnover, and Notre Dame, of course, trying to punish them for that.
Some good looks there. As of late, coming off the pitch is number 24 for the Hoosiers. We have 13:22 left to play here in the second half. Knotted up at once. Phil Fives, number 14 for Indiana, has had a great, great match, along with Thomas, number 11. Sent back towards the keeper, Brian Talcutt. Notre Dame with some big keepers. They go 6-2 and 6-4, respectively. The Chris Hubbard played the first half for Notre Dame. Coach, in basketball, you'll see the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Do they do that for soccer as well? Seems like two really strong conferences.
They have good tournaments, and I know IU has a really tough schedule, so they're usually scheduling, you know, opponents that are very competitive. I know IU's schedule, is as well as Notre Dame, is one of the stronger ones in the nation. But I couldn't tell you if it was...
For IU, Femi Hollingbird Jansen is in, replacing Cory Thomas, number 11.
Once again, Virginia winning this past national championship, 4-2 in penalty kicks over UCLA. Virginia also a part of the ACC along with Notre Dame. So these are two squads that definitely know each other. And it was Virginia that knocked Notre Dame out of the NC2A championship in the third round, winning it 1-0 at Alumni Stadium. Down on the pitch is number 17 for the Irish, John Gallagher. Notre Dame winning it in 2013, so the ACC has won the past two consecutive national championships. Of course, it was IU back in 2012, North Carolina in 2011 out of the ACC, and then Akron won it out of the MAC back in 2010. Coach, does that really surprise you that a mid-major like Akron could pull off an NC2A Division I national championship?
Actually, Akron had started a program, and former is actually an IU alumni that was coaching them, has been coaching them, and now has moved into the MLS ranks. But, I mean, when you get a coaching staff that's coming, you know, from these type of programs,
yeah,
you know, you're getting something good that you can build on.
Absolutely. Great coaching can take a program a long, long way. as we see here in Fort Wayne with Loy Ball at IPFW and the Mastodons volleyball team, Kevin Donnelly with the Cougar football team, the all-time NAIA wins leaders taking St. Francis to 3 national championship games. Absolutely, great coaching. And you saw it with Akron winning the 2010 national championship. Still, though, since 2011, either a Big Ten or an ACC team has won the national championship.
Correct. The ACC and the Big Ten are probably two of the strongest programs, other than maybe like UCLA.
Yep.
Getting in there, they're also a solid program.
Ball left for Tanner Thompson. Tanner's been quiet as of late, but you kind of saw the shift there after those first goals. IU was on the offensive, held the possession. Notre Dame, probably the last 15 minutes with the possession now. We'll see who takes it here with 9:15 left to play in the second half.
Well, I look at it this way. I think IU is being a little more patient with their possession and taking care of the ball. But but Notre Dame being very patient defensively, also keeping compacted. So you're not seeing that many shots, of course. Now there it goes out to the flank.
Good cross opportunity as the header attempt by Hollinger Jansen was defended by the Irish. Still a good looking opportunity. I believe that was number 22 for Indiana. Miguel Galullo with the cross. This Hollinger Jansen's back up off the pitch. Tanner Thompson with the free kick. 8:15 on the clock.
Hollinger Jansen just giving Notre Dame fits just with his work rate.
So easily taken there by Brian Talca as we're inside 8 minutes left to play here in this friendly, tied at 1. Big boot as it's headed forward by the Hoosiers. Sun coming down on Bishop Darcy Stadium as the lights are on. Coach, this is a nice environment here as there's no track around the field and you feel like you're right on top of the pitch. These fans really getting inside the action here.
Yeah, this is a beautiful venue, as like Coach Allison said earlier. The Shindigs director really loves the environment here, and just the view is awesome.
With Mirror Lake in the background here on the campus of the University of St. Francis in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Webb boots it forward. Headed away by Hollinger Jansen. Played out to touch to the Irish. Indiana really keeping their forwards up here, Coach. As it looks like there's just a big grouping and they're gonna retreat back. Is that just because a throw-in, you're not going to get the ball as far as you're on a free kick?
It looks like they're playing 4-2-3-1, which Hollinger Jensen is the striker, lone striker. But once in a while, you'll see some of the outside players come in and switch with him. But they do compact very well to one side when they pressure on the defensive side, especially when they want to pressure Notre Dame up higher on the pitch.
Coach, that seems like that's a good position to be in when you can have four defenders back and just one forward up top. It really speaks to the play of that forward or the striker in Hollinger Jansen.
Right, and just like I said, his work rate is unmatchable right now.
It's number 21 for the Hoosiers, Kyle Sparks. Sparks is from Avon, Indiana, Avon High School. Played out wide to number 20, Tim Mell. Love these big numbers on the back of the jerseys. Very easy to see here atop Bishop Darcy Stadium. Ball headed towards the center of the pitch, picked up by Thompson. Lilliard surveying the pitch. Left foot goes by two Sparks.
There. Could be dangerous.
Sparks was just walled off there by two defenders. Nice play by Brian Talcott coming out, snagging the ball for the Irish. We're inside 5 minutes to play at 4:45, tied up at one.
That's very well done by Talcott, coming out and demanding his area. Or maybe they should take in charge of his area.
Lilliard, chested down by number eight, Redford. Full to see. Sparks is going to leave it up for number 14, Fives. Hollinger Jansen now with the center of the pitch. Leaves it back for Tanner Thompson. Thompson seems to have a quick step when he's cutting there, Coach. Able to get some separation from him and the defender. Jansen tracking it down, trying to keep it in play. Does a good job of doing that. One touch by Tim Mell, taken by the keeper, Talcott.
Yeah, although IU has possessed the ball most of the time, as we talked about the Notre Dame defense staying very compacted. So everything that the Notre Dame defense has given IU is the long crosses. And Talcott has done a good job anticipating those crosses and winning them.
Over the back was number 10 for the Irish, Brandon Aubrey. He's had a fantastic game. On the free kick, it's number 10, Tanner Thompson, with 3:09 left here in the second half.
As we can see, there's 11 Notre Dame players behind the ball, and we're only 30 yards out. So I think they understand there's very little time. They don't want to give up something here in the last couple minutes.
Pretty important free kick there. We got 2:48 now left to play. Thompson's going to play it back to his defender. That's number three. Creviston out to number seven, Foldesey. He's going to play it out to touch to the Irish.
We have an injury on the field.
So the clock,
see the number.
Clock will stop. That's number 14, actually, Fives. Big time player for the Hoosiers. 2:35 on the clock as we got a break in the action. Good opportunity for the players to kind of regroup here for the final 2 minutes and 35 seconds.
Yeah, with this preseason games, I don't know how much they've trained. So conditioning, I don't know how they are as far as their conditioning. You would expect they've been working, but you never know. It's probably first couple of games during the spring season. Probably getting tired.
Well, Fives, he's definitely been all over the pitch here in this game, been very active for the Hoosiers. Once again, Indiana getting their goal from number 11, Cory Thomas, with an assist by Tanner Thompson. That was with 32-12 left here in the second half. Notre Dame scored the first goal, and it was by number 27, Patrick Hodan, with an assist from Max
Makowecki. 24, Trevor Schwartz. Exiting the field, number 14, Phil Fives.
So Fives out of the match now for IU. 2:30 and counting as we're tied up at ones. Hollinger Jansen all by himself, Coach. Plenty of space. Notre Dame doing a good job of collapsing. Thompson's going to send it back to number 20, Mel. Mel lofts it in front of the goal. Keeper punches it away. 50-50.
Again, Notre Dame's keeping very well compacted in the middle, and that's the only thing they're giving IU is the outside.
Coach, you saw the keeper, Brian Talcott, punch that ball away instead of trying to bring it in. Is that just because of the spin of that ball there? It's kind of not so safe to try to grab it?
Yeah, I think he thought the ball was a little farther than, and that's what goalkeepers do. If they can't grab it, what they're going to do is follow through with it and just go ahead and push it away and get it far enough where they're out of trouble.
Good move, cutting back in the middle of the pitch by Lakowecki. We got 1 minute left here in regulation. All alone is number 22, Galullo. Sparks, the Indiana native. Ooh, header was kept away. That was number 8, Redford, with the header for the Hoosiers.
Oh, a shot and a save, and it's over the end zone sweep with that ball.
So some exciting action there for the Hoosiers in the past minute. We got 30 seconds left here in regulation.
First of all, it started out getting out to the flank, like we said. Now we had the front runner in the, on the far side.
Remember, 2 10-minute overtime periods.
Ball kicked forward.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
We have overtime.
So we will have at least 1 10-minute overtime here.
We get some more soccer. 2 10-minute periods. No golden goal. 2 10s. Now would be a time to check the concession stands again. Couple of websites for you to check out. One is the nationalsoccerfestival.com. Check that out. If you want to be involved this August, August 21st and 22nd, if you'd like to have an opportunity to be involved, you need to go to nationalsoccerfestival.com.
So, Coach, we are back here. Jeff Mahoney in the booth with University of St. Francis assistant men's soccer coach Paco Castilla, who also works with the Fort Wayne United Football Club. As coach, we're getting ready to start the first overtime period. 10 minutes on the clock, and we do have a golden goal. Coach, it seems like anybody who's anybody in the city of Fort Wayne soccer is out here at Darcy Stadium to check out this great matchup.
Yeah, this is great for the community. Sometimes we just wish, I know, for the youth, as a matter of fact, this is the first weekend of Indiana Soccer League games. Hopefully some of our youth teams got back in town early enough to get here, and I know some of them probably didn't, but I know that they would love to be out here. So we're probably missing a few, but not too many.
Well, at the center of the pitch is John Gallagher for Notre Dame, along with number 26, Mark Gormley. As we are getting ready to start the overtime period here, 10-minute golden goal rule. Ball played in the direction of Hollinger Jansen. Obviously a smart move for the Hoosiers, as he's been fantastic. Coach has mentioned him many of times, playing out of that striker position. This is Femi Hollinger Jansen. Nice play up to number 10, Tanner Thompson. Cross goes to number 22, Michael Galullo. Just one defender back for the Hoosiers, number 5, Grant Lilliard, you see with the ball. Now number 3 retreats back with him, Derek Creviston.
Indiana's doing a good job spreading the field. But Notre Dame's also doing a fine job keeping their back four compacted and not allowing anything through the middle.
And now it's number 17 for the Irish. Gallagher trying to penetrate that defensive back line. Is able to grab possession, taken down to the pitch, battling with number 7, Matt Foldesi, for the Hoosiers. Thompson, center of the pitch, racing up. Gains control. Coach, that was a different looking play there by the defender, the captain for the Irish. Down there, as it looked like he almost kicked it with his heel.
Yeah, well, the one good thing about it is he's running back to defend his goal. He's also aware where the ball is. That's a good thing about it.
And I believe that's number 25, Patrick Berneski, wearing the captain's armband. Actually, I take that back. All the Irish players have that kind of dark stripe on the sleeve. .743 left here in the first overtime period. Foltzy over to Lilliard. Now we got three defenders back for the Hoosiers as Creviston's out wide right. Middle back, that's Foltz, who plays it up, taken out of the air by number 6, Lakowecki. He had the assist on Notre Dame's only goal in this game. McConnell's throw in goes back to number 22, Galullo.
Notre Dame is happy, just low pressure defense right now as most of their guys are on their half of the field.
Ball played up to number 11, the goal scorer, that's Cory Thomas. Thomas in the center of the pitch, he's in the middle of the action right now. The ball was left for number 22, won that battle. Keeper doing a great job there, coming out, Brian Talcutt, and defusing that play. But we do have a corner kick coming up, Coach.
Yeah, Lekawicki looked like he lost the tackle, first of all, and then that's where the opportunity came inside the box. That could have been a costly mistake.
Tanner Thompson with the corner kick. Picked out of the air. Thompson regains it, 2-on-1. As the header by Lilliard goes wide left. Great opportunity there. Thompson to Lilliard.
But the ball goes wide. Out there on the field right now for the University of Notre Dame. 6, Max Lakowicki. 10 is Brandon Aubrey. 11 is Oliver Harris. 15 is Evan Bankin. 17, John Gallagher. 20 is Blake Towns. 24, Mark Kinshew. 25, Patrick Berneski. 26, Mark Gormley. And 28, Kyle Diedrich. For the Indiana University Hoosiers, number 2, Billy McConnell. 3 is Derek Creviston. 4 is Femi Hollinger Jensen. 5 is Grant Lillard. 7 is Matt Foldesi. 10, Tanner Thompson. 11, Cory Thomas. 20, Tim Mayo. 21, Kyle Sparks. 22, Michael Galullo. And our goalkeepers remain the same.
Great opportunity there for the Irish.
Colin Webb for IU.
That ball's kicked up into the stands. Kids are loving that one, Coach.
Yes, they're involved.
That was number 26, Mark Gormley, really contesting the keeper, Colin Webb, for IU. As we got a whistle.
Yeah, IU's going to have to use the width and the crosses to get in, because Notre Dame just seems to be so compact that nothing's going to come through the middle. It's going to have to be a ball whipped in, kind of like the last attack that IU had.
Yeah, the one where Lillard had the header and it just went wide left.
Correct.
That time that was a shot by Lillard, scooped up by Talca.
Yeah, but I
remember, folks, after the game is over,
autographs and pictures available for you down on the field. We will set up tables down there. You'll have an opportunity to get autographs, take some pictures, that sort of thing.
Great play. Notre Dame now attacking. Huge right foot sent over the crossbar.
He got under the ball a little bit too much there.
Still trying to grab the number from the Notre Dame player, as that was a heavy, heavy shot. It was number 15 for the Irish, Evan Pankton. Thomas doing a great job of getting free. Thomas trying to cut back in, has it taken away from Pankin. Ball's played out to touch to Notre Dame.
Notre Dame is just happy to go ahead and keep on countering on them. And that's how they're getting their opportunities. Because right now, possession is mostly IU.
2:45 left to play here in the first overtime. Golden ball rule here. First team to score will have bragging rights until next fall. IU, obviously, they did win the last matchup. It was a game played in Bloomington, Indiana. With the Hoosiers winning it 1-0 on October the 22nd. Played out to touch once again to the Hoosiers. Notre Dame with that tight, tight D.
And as we said, here he goes another counter.
Making a push up the pitch was number 17, John Gallagher. Nice ball movement there by the Irish.
3-4 touches and out to a different zone. That's well done.
Coach Lott is always made of, you know, do they play a Brazilian style or what kind of style of soccer do they play? What do you see in these two teams?
I think this is the American soccer where you try to get a balance of those different cultures, because I think the American player has, they are some of the best athletes in the world, and you got to use your space. And to get that, you know, you have to open it up. You don't play a Brazilian or tiki-taka type of soccer. But you do stretch the field to get the individual 1v1 matchups and so on and so forth. And you have the athletes to do that. And, of course, IU and Notre Dame, with their skill, some, as you can see, some of them can do a lot when you get 1v1. All other players are capable of doing it.
And you're exactly right, Coach. It seems like every single player down here on the pitch can take that 1v1 and make something happen for you. When you talk about the two styles, the possession style with the Brazilian and then the English style of really just kind of kicking the ball forward and trying to get those one-on-one matchups.
4-3-2-1.
As I said, it's not a right or wrong way about it. It's just like I said, Notre Dame's very well organized.
And we'll have one more 10-minute overtime period, unless, of course, at some point during it there is a goal, in which case that's it. Then we will go to autographs and pictures on the field.
When you defend the way that Notre Dame does, what happens, it creates space behind the defense, because IU, the way they've been controlling the possession, has a tendency to start getting numbers into the attack. Therefore, the space is going to be behind the defense. So this is what Notre Dame looks. They're coming out.
Thank you to our sponsors, and please do support them. Organizations like Federated Media, the Wilson Foundation, Brigadoon Fitness, ATM, Burton Bossmer and Looney Financial Advisory Group.
They pick and choose Notre Dame as well as IU. They pick and choose very well.
And of course, thanks for the support at our end zone suites.
Went to possess.
The alumni associations from Notre Dame and IU. Caldwell Banker, John Bellio, and Jerry Jenkins. The three amigos. Brad Fisher, Michael Morrissey, and Joe Zimmerman. Three Rivers Federal Credit Union and Andrew Krause. And of course, our main sponsor, Shindigz. Go to shindigz.com. Check out, see what they can do for you, your family, your organization when you want to put on some kind of a party, some kind of a special occasion, and you want it to be fantastic. That's who you want to check out.
So, Coach, going back down to your explanation, you said IU keeps that short possession game. As they get closer to the goal, then you'll see a larger grouping of Hoosiers down there, and that really gives Notre Dame an opportunity to counter off that? Or
Yes, you start seeing the outside backs, the left and outside. That's where they get their width, and they're the ones, you know, serving the ball in. So when they get caught up in the attacking third and all of a sudden they lose possession, they're taking more risk. So then when Notre Dame comes out, you know, it looks like IU only has two defenders back here. So, you know, it's like I said, the organization, it's, you kind of take your numbers and kind of look at it. Can we attack? Can we possess? Because Notre Dame has had their moments when they're attacking, but they're possessing also in the attack. They're not possessing too much out of the back.
And you've seen it where it looks like Notre Dame has numbers on the offensive end, and IU doing a great job of retreating back and really helping.
During that overtime, we did have another IU player that was inserted into the match, number 27, Brad Shaw.
So Brad Shaw back in for the Hoosiers. So that one touch makes its way up to Shaw. Shaw with some fresh legs down there, the left-footed cross looking for number 22. Is possessed by Michael Galullo. Left-footed shot, and it's in for a goal!
And a shot from out and right through the crowd, and
Tanner Thompson. Just 40 seconds in, Tanner Thompson with the goal from downtown. What a great looking shot, Coach.
Yeah, Thompson. He's been at it most of the game. He's been the one penetrating, and that was very fortunate to get it out to the right and give him a drop ball where he had a clear shot.
We can't figure out exactly who scored on that one or who had the assist.
Yeah, it was definitely looking like number 10.
Tanner Thompson. The one that scored.
Not sure there was an assist there, Coach, as he looked to have possession of the ball. But what an unbelievable shot. And is that a case there where there's just so many players there? Maybe the keeper, Brian Talka, was a little bit blinded there with so many players in the middle.
Well, I'm not so sure there wasn't an assist. I believe it was crossed.
The autograph tables are now being set up. You're able to take pictures, get autographs.
I believe it was crossed, and then Cory Thompson won the ball
signed.
On the right side of
absolutely.
The pitch. And then he's the one that dropped the ball back to him.
Nonetheless, just a great-looking shot there.
Coach, thank you to all of our sponsors. But
a great friendly here between Notre Dame.
To Indiana University and the University of Notre Dame, these two soccer teams.
Absolutely.
All of the players.
Can't thank these universities enough.
And of course,
enough.
The two head coaches, Bobby Clark and Todd Yeagley. And we do also thank our four referees. And congratulations once again to Andrew Bigelow on being able to step up and do professional soccer.
But yeah, Coach, your final thoughts on this great friendly here?
Oh, it's great to see the community come together and you know, enjoy good soccer here in Fort Wayne. And, you know, seeing, watching these two teams is a good quality soccer that our kids can get educated, especially in our youth programs. So hopefully we Terry can keep on doing this and move forward with the plans.
Well, let's review the scoring. It was 12 minutes into the second half when Notre Dame got the first goal of the match. Patrick Hodan put it in the back of the net with the assist from number 6, Mac Lakowecki. It was just a minute later when number 10, Tanner Thompson, found Cory Thomas with the goal, and we were tied up at 1. This game finished the regulation period in a tie. First overtime went to a tie. And then 40 seconds into the second overtime, it was Tanner Thompson from up top. Looked like he was about 20, 25 yards out. Drilled the back of the net for the go-ahead goal. The Hoosiers winning it 2-1 here in two overtimes. Well, folks, we appreciate you guys watching today's broadcast. And with Paco Castilla, I'm Jeff Mahoney, signing off here from Bishop Darcy Stadium. Thanks for joining us.